Thank you. Is he worthy this morning?
Amen.
Has he done anything for you?
Amen.
Amen. Has he answered your prayers for you? Amen. Has he supplied your each and every need?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, let's wake up then. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Thank God for seeing everyone here today. I want to welcome you. Redemption Harvest. Amen. Say amen. We're visiting. We're glad to have you. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Go ahead. Kids can go to children's church. I've been doing this a long time. And I have learned to preach at times when I have to fight the enemy to do it. I've learned to preach no matter what hindering spirit. If you're glad to be here, look at your neighbor and say, I'm so glad to be in God's house.
I'm so glad to be in God's house.
It's where I find help. Paul addresses the church of Corinth. Let me give this.
they're dealing with not only God's spirit. They're dealing with spirits in the church that should not be there. They have within the walls of this church not only men that speak with tongues and prophesy, they have within the same church a man that's sleeping with his stepmother. How out of the same fountain can come forth sweet and bitter water? So Paul addresses this church right in the midst of their spiritual outpouring of gifts. Because chapter 12 tells us of the gifts of the Spirit. Chapter 14 tells us of more gifts of the Spirit. And they identify them gifts in a greater depth. So there's no doubt that they are a spiritual church. But they got some issues. So he comes back with chapter 13. And if the Lord will help me, I will preach from there this morning. Is that all right? Though I speak with tongues of men and of angels, and have not love, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith, so that I could remove mountains and have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, though I give my body to be burned and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. For love suffers long. You with me? Love suffers long. Love is kind. Love envieth not. Love vaunteth not itself. Love is not puffed up. Love does not behave itself unseemly. Love seeketh not its own, or her own. It is not easily provoked. Love thinks no evil. Love doesn't rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Love beareth all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and love endures all things. Love never, 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 never fails.
Amen.
That's God's love. But whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but then that which is perfect is come. That which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spake as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I become a man, I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know, even as I also am known. And now about faith, hope, and love, these three, but the greatest of these is love. You can be seated in the presence of the Lord. I'm going to take a strange thought as far as a strange message this morning. It hit me sitting right over there. Right in the midst of this spiritual church. My mind went back to Luke's Gospel, chapter 15, and let me read it to you. It's a very familiar passage. I won't read what I'm going to preach or what I'm going to get to, but I want to read the opening verses of chapter 15 of Luke's Gospel. Notice that Jesus is doing his earthly ministry, and I'm going to preach whether the devil likes it or not, so you might as well know. Notice that he is doing his earthly ministry, and he is surrounded not only by sinners that have come out of every city, but he is surrounded by the church, the Pharisees, and the scribes. And chapter 15 says this, then drew near unto him all the publicans and the sinners to hear Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes begin to murmur, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eats with them. What a truer statement. No truer statement can be made concerning our Lord and our Savior, but that he loves sinners enough Jesus wasn't condoning sin, no sir. He was looking beyond the sin and seeing the sinner. Aren't you glad this morning that our God that we're serving looks beyond our sin? He doesn't see the adulterous woman caught in the very act of adultery. He sees a soul that's damaged and on their way to hell. He doesn't see the woman that comes to draw water from the well that's been married 5 times and shacking up with somebody now that don't even love her enough to give her his name. He doesn't see that woman that's an outcast down in Samaria. He sees a woman that's thirsty in her soul, and he says to her, listen, if you knew who was talking to you, you'd ask of me living water, and it'd be a well springing up into you, life everlasting, and it would never run dry. He doesn't see a blind man sitting by the wayside that's interfering with his evangelistic tour. He sees a man that has no eyes in his eye sockets. His eyes are blind. He sees a soul that needs to be changed. When our Lord and our Savior looks at humanity, he doesn't see 10 leprous, diseased men that he should never be around or should never touch. No, sir, our Savior sees men that are diseased, damaged, and on their way to eternity without him. And he loves them enough to refuse to leave them where they are at. I come by to tell somebody this morning, doesn't matter what state you are in, doesn't matter how you walk in this church, it doesn't matter if you're in the category of a sinner or you're a sinner sitting in the church. I'm telling you, all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We're all sinners in the sight of a God that's righteous. But aren't you glad this morning that he'll pull up a seat, he'll sit down at the table, he'll eat with you? Doesn't matter what you've done, where you've been, or how long you've been there, the God I'm serving this morning loves you enough to leave you there.
Thank you, Jesus. Have your way.
He doesn't have a problem with a sinner. He receives them. He eats with them. But notice in Luke 15 who he's addressing here. He's preaching the sermon to the Pharisees and the scribes. They've come to hear him, that religious crowd, those church people. And isn't it strange that in the church we can act like we got it all together? And we won't let anybody think we're spiritual. We're speaking in tongues and we're prophesying and we're laying hands on the sick. Now in that same church in Corinth, there was some messed up folk. Out of that same church, there were some hypocrites that were in the church. You say, preacher, I don't want to go to the church with a hypocrite. Too late, honey. The church is full of them. And I'd rather go to church with them than to go to hell with them. Are you hearing what I'm telling you? We got room for one more hypocrite. Come on over. Because there's going to be a time in your life that you're going to miss the mark. There's going to be a time in your life after you said, I know him, that you're going to end up denying him, either by word or by action. There's going to be a time when you sell him out for something that you never dreamed that you choose over him. All of us have had issues. Listen, Jesus didn't have issue with the man that said, I'm a sinner. In fact, he sat down and eat with him and received him unto himself. But the problem was that in the midst of that crowd of sinners, some church people had gathered and began to say to each other, this man is not a prophet. He can't be a savior. He's not even a Jew. If he was, he wouldn't sit down at a table and eat with somebody that sinned as much as these sinners sinned.
Come on now. Bless him, Lord. Have your way with him, Lord.
him. And so Jesus tells the story. Have I got time?
Come on now.
He tells the story. A certain man had two sons. A certain man had two sons. He was a wealthy man. And the Bible said, Jesus said, the youngest son come to the father and said to the father, give me the portion that falleth to me. See, according to the Levitical law, this young man could have, the father could have summoned all of his neighbors together, brought that young man out of his house, stuck him in the middle of the yard, and according to the Levitical law, he had dishonored his father by asking for his inheritance before it was time for his father to die. So the Bible would lead us to believe that this father would have the right, according to that Levitical law, to stone that son and allow the neighbors to help stone him. But Jesus didn't have a problem, no sir, with the son that had want and desire. See, I want to say this to you. Some of us are sitting here and we argue and we would complain about somebody that's got want and desire. And the only reason we argue about people that's got want and desire is that we have lost our own desire for the very things of God. We don't understand when somebody gets excited in the church, somebody's overzealous, somebody gets full of God, somebody's not acting like we're acting, they're too radical in the church. We don't understand that because we have forgotten the days when we used to have a shout and we used to be radical. We have forgotten what it felt like to have desire to spring up in you. This young man's only problem was he had a desire and a want that the older brother did not have. Give me the goods that follow to me. He says to his father, and the Bible said, and his father divided unto them his living. One son asked, the other one received. Listen, it is that one young son is a representative of the sinner that Jesus would receive back into the fold. That oldest brother was a representative of that Pharisee church that looked like they had it all together on the outside. They dressed up for the part, but somewhere down inside of them, there was a spirit living in them, hallelujah, that they could not overcome because they would not humble themselves.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, everything, Lord. Yes, thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Thank you, Lord.
The younger boy grabbed what he could grab of his father's inheritance, and the Bible said he took a long journey. He took a journey to a far country. He got in that far country, and according to the Bible, along the way, he spent everything he could. The Bible said, in riotous living. Listen, you know what that means? It means wild and uncontrollable lifestyle. Are you hearing me? He had something that got attached to himself that he could not shake. He had a wild spirit, uncontrollable spirit that got onto him and drove him into that far country. I mean, y'all know that when a sinner leaves the house of God and goes to a far country, it's not too many days. I feel like the preacher told me. I said, it's not too many days until he finds in that far country that there is a famine there. Famine always comes to the sinner. In fact, God uses the famine to drive the sinner back to the house of God. Don't look down on a backslider. Hallelujah. God will use a famine to get them back. And when they get hungry, hallelujah, when they get thirsty for something more than that world Father's house.
Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Lord.
God uses the right of
bless you, Lord. Have your way with you, Lord. Thank you,
Jesus. Yeah, Lord. Answer that woman's prayer. Have your way.
Thank you.
He goes to that far country and a famine comes out. And he looks around. He would have joined himself. The Bible says he joined himself to a citizen of that country. He became in covenant relationship with a citizen of that country. That citizen loved him enough not to feed him, but to send him to the hog pen. You can play around the world all you want to. They ain't so free. Ain't only one person that loves you. And that's the provider, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
He said, that citizen said, I don't love you enough to feed you, but I'll tell you what you can do. You can work for me. Go down to the hog pen. That citizen, knowing he was a Gentile, he knew that Jewish boys believed that he couldn't even be at a hog pen. He couldn't touch a hog. He couldn't get mud on him. But the Bible said that citizen sent him to the hog pen. Told him down to the hog pen. He said, I got dinner. I got hungry. I looked down in that slop bucket. And that slop, I was so hungry, the slop looked good to me. I would have eaten of the husk that the hogs did eat. I'm telling you that God can use a slop bucket. At the hog pen that you will never forget once you come back home. I found out you learn more about God at a hog pen than you can at the Father's house. While everything's going good, while grace is great, you're shouting praising God at the house, at the Father's house. You know one thing about God, but when you get down the mountain and you're in the hog pen of despair and it looks like you're going to die there, so bad. I've got to tell that. you've done. God accepts you because love.
Amen.
Never fails.
Amen.
He accepts you because love is long-suffering. He accepts you because love is not puffed up. He's not mad about it. He ain't puffed up. In fact, he knew that before long, before you ever got to the pulpit, that there was a tendency in you because you were an immature child to find your way down the road to a pulpit. Before you ever quit God, those years ago, he knew you was ready to quit and knew the day you would quit and knew the reason. Which leads in the house of the Father, but not be with the Father. You can be linked up to his house. Doesn't mean you're linked up to him.
That's right.
As he drew nigh to the house, he heard music. Listen to this. He heard music and dancing. I read that one. I was like, never seen that in the Chronicles. So he heard music and dancing. What about the sermon? We can step out in the Father's house and come for the entertainment of the music and the dancing and the shouting. But if you never hear the sermon, you're as lost sitting in the house as that sinner out there in the home.
That's right.
When he heard the music and the dancing, he asked the servant. Come here, brother servant. What in the world?
I forgot about him.
Because that's the attitude of most churches.
Uh-huh.
When a sinner comes in, I can't shake his hand, her hand, I don't know. I don't know what they've been involved in, what they've been tied to. I don't know how low they really are. So we just sit here in the church, forgetting where God brought us from.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
God bless the Lord.
That's right.
So he says, my brother's home, that dirty devil, he don't deserve. Come on, walk with me. I'm going to testify about my brother for a minute. My brother don't deserve music. He don't deserve rejoicing. He don't deserve the part. Don't push, don't press up. Don't tell me. I know what he does. This is nowhere in this prodigal son's testimony, but the brother says this about his own brother. He said, that boy, you know what he done? He took my daddy's inheritance. His portion of it. Let me give you the Jewish portion. The oldest son of the father's inheritance, if there was two boys, the oldest son got two-thirds.
Yes.
And the youngest son got one-third. He took one-third of my daddy's goods. He's focused on the one-third instead of what's been given to him, the two-thirds. We get so focused when sinners come into church. I try to find out how dirty they are and where they've been instead of focusing on how blessed we are from the Father's inheritance to us who have not left the church. You know what he did? Oh, his brother. He spent that money on harlots. He laid around with some women. Now, the prodigal son never says that. His testimony never brings up that. This, and how did that older brother know that his younger brother in a far country was wasting his daddy's money on harlots? Or was he just confessing something he thought his brother done? Or if the Bible is correct, and it is,
amen.
Out of the heart, the mouth speaks. So was he in reality saying, my younger brother spent his money on harlots because though he was at the house, in his own heart, as a man thinketh, so is he. If you want to judge somebody and say they've been out there laying down with harlots, it might be because if you got the chance, it don't matter what. He wasted it, laid down with harlots. He drank it up, he parted that wild, uncontrolled living. what I'm going to do. You go tell Daddy I'm not coming to his party. Stop right there. According to Levitical law, under Jewish tradition, if a father hosted a party, for his son not to come to the party was disrespect to the father. He dishonored him, and the same law that said the younger son could be stoned for asking for his daddy's inheritance before it's time was the same law that said the oldest boy could be stoned for not coming to the daddy, to his daddy's party. You don't have to get involved when the church is rejoicing and shouting and praising God, and people are crying and holding up their head. You stay outside. You can sit right in the pew and be outside the house. You don't have to get involved, but you are dishonoring.
That's right.
The father, you disrespected the father.
That's right. Amen.
So you come down here. I'll show him who I am. I ain't coming to his party. Stay at the party. Who wants the party anyway? I'm not in the mood to party. So the servant goes back and tells the father. This is what happens. That father does the same thing for that oldest boy that he does for that younger boy. And he comes out of his own house. You won't come in? I'll come out. You ever had God show up in the hall again? Have you ever been away from God and couldn't get away from God?
Yeah.
You really helped me. You ever not had your mind on church? Your back's getting away from God, and all of a sudden, the radio pops on. And there's a song that used to touch you. So the father said, if you ain't coming in, I'll come back to you. He comes out on the porch. He sits down in the field, wherever he went to. He comes to him and he says, no, this is what's wrong. He says, I can't believe you letting my younger brother come home with you. He spent everything you gave him on righteous living, on spent it with harlots. He said, son, there's a reason for the music. We're dancing and we're rejoicing because your brother, he reminds you. Your brother that was lost is now found.
Amen.
He was dead, but he is now alive.
Uh-huh.
I got to listen to you. Because I'm looking for a happy ending.
Uh-huh.
When it comes to this story, I want this story to end with something so rejoicing that makes me go, my gosh, God not only saved the boy from the hog pen, but he also got that oldest son. Mm-hmm. But here's what the Bible says. The Bible says that he answered and said unto his father, lo, these many years do I serve thee. I serve thee, neither have I transgressed at any time any of your commandments, and yet thou never gavest me a kid. I may make merry with my friends. He wasn't worried about a robe, a ring, or shoes, or the kiss. That Pharisee boy only wanted a kid so he could party with his friends. Whether he was... He just got through accusing his younger brother of living a lies life, which was a wild and uncontrolled life. And the only thing this older boy's got in his mind, you never gave me a kid, a calf, a lamb, something I could kill so I could party. What was in his heart? Living in the father's house with a party on his mind. I don't want the ring that says I'm yours. I don't want the robe of righteousness. I don't want to walk in your shoes, Daddy. I don't want the kiss of your love. I just want the party. He was as lost in his father's house as that boy was in the hog pen. Let me go on and read, because this is not even happy. Listen to this. You never gave me a kid that that I may make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come home, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, but this thy son, or that this thy brother was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And the chapter is. Because we've been in the Father's house for years. Everybody knows what we said. And nobody, bless God, been against. Everybody knows what we said in the Father's house. Everybody knows what we'll do. They know that we'll be here. We'll be here Sunday morning. We might come back on Sunday. Wednesday night, we know the routine of the Father's house. We know what we're doing. Somewhere in the midst of that routine, we become lost. Are we so used to working in the fields of the Father? So used to having the rake in our hand, the sheath in our hand, the blade in our hand, working for Daddy? And in the midst of our work, lost. Years ago, I used to preach pastors' conferences all the time. One of the things that I heard over and over and over and over again from preachers that would come to me one-on-one when I would preach these pastor conferences and I would deal with issues of pastors. Well, every time I did a pastor, I've had preachers come to me, pastors come to me and say, I'm working, I'm doing ministry, I'm singing songs, I'm leading the choir, I'm teaching Sunday school, I'm preaching the sermons, I'm visiting the sick, I'm doing weddings, I'm doing funerals, I'm doing it all. I'm lost. Not that they hadn't never been saved. They've lost their desire. They've lost the zeal. They've lost the excitement of being in the Father's house. You can say what you want to this morning, but I'll guarantee you, God looks with my message, Brother Tony. If there wasn't some of us sitting here right now that are burned out with going through the routine, and we want to blame the routine for why we're burned out, we're not burned out for the routine. We're not burnt out because the Father's house. We are burnt out because our priorities. We aren't seeking the Father's face. We're seeking His hand. Give me the goods. I want possession. I want you to bless me. That's not the church. I want you to bless. Lay it in my hand. That's seeking His hand.
That's right.
It's not seeking His face.
That's right.
I don't need possessions. They will come when I seek His presence.
Yeah.
When I seek His face.
That's right.
get ready to come to music. This morning, by a show of hands, I want you to just think about what come to you and ask you. But by the show of hands, who in here would raise their hand? And in doing so, you just say, "Preacher, that sermon got me." You're right. I don't know how long the journey was. Everybody listen to me real quick. I don't know how long the journey was from the father's house to the hog pen for that youngest boy. Don't know. You don't care. I don't know how long it took him to walk that road. But here's the question I really want to ask. I'm not concerned about how long it took him to leave the father's house and get in the hog pen, as much as I'm concerned with how long it took the older brother to lose his desire while working for the Father. How long did it take for that oldest boy to become just as lost as that boy at the hog pen, but yet never leave the Father's house? You know why there was a hindered spirit in this church? Sister AJ came up today, and y'all said a wonderful thing. She said today, there was a hindering spirit here this morning. I just looked at her. She said, "You probably already know that. Thank you for letting me know." I mean, not saying like she let me know. Don't believe any witness. Any word unless it's given by two witnesses. You know why there's a hindrance spirit here? It's because we become lost sitting in this house. What is your desire? What is your passion? What are you chasing? What are you running after? Something that disappoints your natural father, and he'll look at you like, and you knew by the look, "Dad's not pleased with me." If God looked at us right now, looked at you individually, looked at me individually, would he be shaking his head? Look at all the stuff I gave around this plantation. All of the chores, but you are a long ways off. You're lost?
Know it.
I'm not talking about being lost like going to hell. I'm talking about lost. Lost. I'll do a paper. She tells me. All they say. These altars are open. I want you to come. If the message hits you this morning, if it's, there's some area in your life that you need to, God, I need help on that. I want to feel alive. I want to feel free. While they say, "Won't you get around?"
Give the Lord a hand clap. Today's Father's Day, we always give out gifts, certificates, and stuff to fathers, just like we do on Mother's Day. They made this package childproof. We're going to give out gifts if it's just to honor some of the dads and fathers. We're going to have a little bit of fun with them. Is that all right? I'm going to be the first one to a dad that has a kid in detail. I mean, this child really detailed. Terry looking at Eli. Eli's looking at Terry going, "Dad, you're getting this." I think on Eli more than I think on any kid in this church. And thank you for raising the truck. Well, then again, what you do. Terry's Eli and Ethan's dad. Ethan's the good one, and Terry and Eli's out here somewhere. I love Eli. He goes all the time. He tells me he wants to come to my house 2 or 3 times a week. That would be crazy. So, take that back. Let's give it to David. Thank you. This back, we're going to give it to the dad that not only has 2 hard daughters to raise, he's also got 2 son-in-laws that ain't worth killing. Give that to Jim. Jim told me the other day he had a real hard time raising 2 girls and dying at the same time. Young man sitting right back there, gray headed, right on the back row right there. Give that to him. I love you. God bless you. And I'll see you Wednesday night at 7:00.